friends. In the previous lecture, we have learnt about cast irons and cast steels. Now, in this lecture, let us learn about aluminium and magnesium cast alloys. First, we will see the aluminium cast alloys. Next, we will see the magnesium cast alloys, aluminium cast alloys. First, let us see the characteristics of aluminium. Aluminium is light in weight. Its specific weight is substantially lower than other common metals. Aluminium alloys are suitable for all known casting process. Means there are different casting process are there, sand casting, die casting, investment casting. Aluminium can be used for all the casting process. Aluminium has outstanding formability and can be processed in variety of ways. Next, aluminium alloys are distinguished by an excellent degree of homogeneity, means uniform composition everywhere. Aluminium and aluminium alloys are easy to machine. Their machinability is good. Next one, aluminium is an excellent conductor of electricity and heat. Aluminium alloys castings can be given an artificial wear resistant and corrosion resistant layer. So that is easy in the case of the aluminium castings. Next one, aluminium is non-magnetic. Aluminium is non-toxic, hygienic and physiologically harmless. Aluminium is an outstanding recyclic material. Right? So these are all the advantages, in fact, characteristics of aluminium. Now these are the demerits of aluminium cast alloys. High shrinkage. The shrinkage will be nearly 4 to 8%, and it is highly susceptible to shrinkage defects and also shrinkage porosity. Now it has the highest hydrogen, what say, absorbability. It absorbs hydrogen rapidly. Now susceptibility to hot cracking as well as cold cracking. During solidification, this hot cracking develops. Now there is another cold cracking. Cold cracking means during solidification it absorbs hydrogen, and this hydrogen will be atomic hydrogen because of the what say high temperature. Now during solidification, this atomic hydrogen will become molecular hydrogen, and as the solidification is progressing, as the interatomic spaces are reducing, the molecular hydrogen cannot be accommodated inside. Thus it what say exerts pressure inside, and that is how it results in cracking. So this is the cold cracking. So it has the susceptibility to hot cracking as well as cold cracking, and it has low ductility. Now let us see, that's why the pure aluminium may not be suitable for the casting purposes, but we can alloy it. We can add different alloying elements and we can make it useful for our what say casting purposes. Now when we say alloying elements, we can see there are 4 types of additives are there. First one is the major alloying elements, typically include silicon, copper and magnesium. So these are the major alloying elements in aluminium. Next one, there will be minor alloying elements. So these are nickel, tin, right? So these are found largely in alloys that are likely to would not be high in integrated die castings. Next one, apart from the major alloying elements and minor alloying elements, there will be microstructure modifying elements. Means what is the purpose? We are what say modifying the microstructure, right? So these include titanium, boron, strontium, phosphorus, beryllium, manganese and chromium. So we add these elements extremely small amount, so that the composition is almost unaltered, but it will be changing the microstructure. Next one, there will be impurity elements. What are these impurity elements? Means these are the elements coming in through the aluminium without our knowledge and without our intention. So such elements are called as the impurity elements, or they are also known as the residual elements. So these typically include iron, chromium and zinc. So iron is the most common what say impurity element in the aluminium. Next is the chromium and also the zinc. So these are the 4 types of the additives that we can see in the aluminium castings. First we will see the major alloying elements, next we will see the minor alloying elements, next microstructure modifying elements, next we will see the effects of the impurity elements. First we will see the major alloying elements. Now among the what say major alloying elements, first one is the silicon. Silicon is the what say most what say used alloying element. It is the number one major alloying elements in the aluminum castings. Now, what is its role? Silicon's high heat of fusion contributes immensely to alloy's fluidity or fluid life. Now, it has got the high heat of fusion, means what happens during solidification, during the phase change, it liberates lot of heat. Now, because it is liberating lot of heat, what happens, its what say temperature of the alloy will be increasing, that is how the fluidity will be increasing. As the temperature is increasing, fluidity will be increasing. So, silicon contributes to the fluidity of the aluminum alloy. Next one, its limited solid solubility maximum will be 1.65 and formation of a eutectic with aluminum at a significantly high level 12% results in large volume fraction of isothermal solidification. This helps in avoiding hot tearing or hot cracking issues. So, silicon is not only increasing the fluidity, but it is also helping us to what say prevent the hot cracking. Next one, thermal expansion of silicon is very low. Hence, the more silicon an alloy contains, the lower is its thermal expansion coefficient. Most of the times what happens, as the what say we pour the molten metal, what happens if the what say thermal expansion of the alloy is high, what happens, the mold cavity may break because of the high thermal what say expansion of the alloy. But because of the silicon, the thermal expansion will be minimum, that is how there won't be any what say mold damage. Next one, there are other roles made by the silicon. Silicon forms a very hard phase. If we see the silicon, it is a very hard material, thus it contributes significantly to an alloy's wear resistance. Because it is very hard, when we mix this hard silicon in the aluminum melt, what happens, it improves the wear resistance of the alloy. Next one, silicon combines with other elements to improve an alloy's strength and make alloy's heat treatable. Next one, silicon can cause a permanent increase in a casting's dimensions termed growth if the part is not thermally stabilized before being put into elevated temperature service. Next one, the other what's a major alloying element of aluminum is the copper. Now, what is the role of copper on the properties of aluminum alloys? Copper offers highest strength and hardness to the aluminum alloys. So, the most commonly used what say alloy is the duralumin, it contains copper. Why the duralumin is very hard and strong? Because it contains copper. It improves machinability. On the downside, copper generally reduces the corrosion resistance. Aluminum copper alloys don't contain silicon, hence the fluidity decreases. Next one, the major alloying element is the magnesium. Now, what is the role of magnesium on the properties of aluminum alloys? Magnesium combines with silicon to form the hardening phase magnesium silicate. You see, Mg2Si, so this is a very hard phase. Because of that, what happens, the what say alloy what say develops good strength and also wear resistance. This hard phase provides strengthening and heat treatment basis for the aluminum silicon alloys, popularly known as the 356 family of alloys. Next one, this hard phase also provides strength to the aluminum magnesium alloys. So, magnesium typically it what say forms the hardening phase, thus it what say induces strength to the alloy. Now, we have completed the major alloying elements of the aluminum. Next, we will see the minor alloying elements. Among the minor alloying elements, the first minor alloying element is the nickel. Nickel enhances the hot strength and hardness of aluminum copper alloys. It is employed for the same purpose in some aluminum silicon 3XX alloys, but its effectiveness in the silicon containing alloys is less dramatic. Next one, another minor alloying element is the tin. What is its role? Tin in aluminum tin alloys, so these are popularly known as 8XX series, we will see later. Now, this tin reduces friction, right, in bearings and bushing applications. The tin phase in those alloys melts at a very low temperature at about 227 degrees. Now, then what happens? Tin exudes under emergency conditions to provide short term liquid lubrication to rubbing surfaces if such bearing bushings severely overheat in service. So, this is the greatest advantage of using in the bearings. So, this tin is used for the bearing applications in the manufacture of the bearings. Now, what happens in the bearings? One part will be rubbing over another part. So, most of the times we use the lubricants. Now, okay, fine, sometimes this lubricant may be exhausted or there may not be any lubricant. What will happen? Then heat will be developed. Now, the one part will be rubbing over another part. What will happen? Finally, the parts will be damaged severely. At such times, what happens? This tin exudes under emergency conditions and it will be supplying few drops, minor drops of liquid tin at the, what say, rubbing surfaces. Then it causes the lubrication between the rubbing parts. So, this is the greatest advantage of tin. Next one, so far we have completed the major alloying elements and the minor alloying elements. Next, we will see the microstructure modifying elements. Among the microstructure modifying elements, the popular what's elements are the titanium and boron. And what are their roles? Titanium and boron are used to refine primary aluminum grains. Initially, if we do not use any what say modifier, the grain will be very coarse. When we use this what say modifiers like titanium and boron, we get a very fine what say grain structure. Titanium alone added as a titanium aluminum master alloy forms TiAl3, you see, which serves to nucleate primary aluminum dendrites. More frequent nucleation means large number of smaller grains. Now, we can see here, this is the unrefined grain structure and here this is the refined grain structure. This refined grain structure offers us better mechanical properties. That is why there is a need to add microstructure modifying elements. Next one, role of strontium, sodium, calcium and antimony. So, these are also, they also come under the microstructure modifying elements. So, these elements, one or another, but not in combination, only one should be used at a time, are added to eutectic or hypoeutectic aluminum silicon casting alloys to modify the morphology of the eutectic silicon face. Modification with one of the above elements, say you see the proportion 0.01 to 0.025%, extremely small amount, changes the eutectic silicon into a fine fibrous or lamellar structure. And here this is the unmodified. So, this is modified and this is super modified. So, this what say microstructure modifying elements like strontium, sodium, calcium and antimony, only one at a time, but not in combination, helps us to get a better what say microstructure with improved properties. Next one, among the microstructure modifying elements, the next what say elements are the manganese and chromium. And what are their roles? Manganese and or chromium cause a beneficial change to the morphology of iron phases. With large concentrations of iron, manganese and chromium can minimize shouldering of the cast melt to steel, steel tooling during die casting. So, in the die casting applications, so there is a drawback called shouldering, means there will be metallic dies will be used. So, the molten metal will be sticking to the metallic dies. So, this is the shouldering. So, this problem can be minimized when we use these what say modifying elements like manganese and chromium. Next one, the last additives, these are the impurity elements, or these are also known as the residual elements. Among them, the first one is the iron. And what is its role? Iron is present in most of the traditional aluminum alloys as an impurity, means it comes into the alloy without our knowledge and without our intention. Yet, it is very useful impurity. Though it is coming into the alloy without our knowledge and without our intention, it gives us some benefits. Iron in the concentrations of, say, you see the concentration, maybe 0.08, this is the normal composition, at the most it will be 1% or more greatly, right? It reduces the tendency of an alloy to shoulder to the die casting tooling. Again, say there is a drawback, right? This shouldering defect can be reduced in the die casting. Iron also reduces the tendency of hot tearing, right? So again, hot tearing or the hot cracking, another drawback in the aluminum castings. So this aluminum, which comes into the alloy as an impurity element or as a residual element, minimizes the hot tearing. Next one, another impurity, that is the zinc. Zinc is present merely as an acceptable impurity element in many secondary scrap based die casting alloys. As such, zinc is quite neutral. It is neither enhances nor detracts the alloy's properties. The only intentional and controlled additions of zinc to aluminum casting alloys are in the 7XX series, right. So these alloys are not yet suitable for the die casting or any of its variations. Only in one case, that is the 7XX series, we will be seeing these later within few minutes, right. So in those series, this is intentionally alloyed or intentionally added for obtaining certain properties. Now let us see the classification of aluminum casting alloys. We have seen the different, what say, alloying elements, the major alloying elements, the minor alloying elements, what say microstructure modification elements, and the what say impurities we have seen. Next are the how these aluminum alloys are classified, on what basis. Now this is the classification of the aluminum cast alloys. Aluminum cast alloys are grouped based on the major alloying element present in that. Based on that, they are classified. Aluminum greater than 99% is designated as 1XX series. Means here, it is mostly the pure aluminum. 99% aluminum is present. It is mostly the aluminum. No other element is there. No other major alloying element is there, except few what say residual elements may be there, or minor alloying elements will be there. So this is the 1XX series. An aluminum alloy with copper as the major alloying element is designated as 2XX series. In this series, copper is the main alloying element. Next one, an aluminum alloy with silicon with added copper and or magnesium is designated as 3XX series. Means in this series, silicon is the main alloying element, but it also contains little amount of copper or magnesium or both, and this series is known as the 3XX series. Next one, an aluminum alloy with silicon as the major alloying element. In the previous case also silicon is present, but along with silicon, copper and magnesium were also present, but here in the 4XX series, only silicon is the main alloying element. Now when the only silicon is present as the main alloying element or the major alloying element, it is designated as 4XX series. Next one, an aluminum alloy with magnesium as the major alloying element is designated as 5XX series. Here the major alloying element is magnesium. Next, there will be one unused series will be there, 6XX series. So this is not used till now. Next one, an aluminum alloy with zinc as the main alloying element with small additions of copper, magnesium, chromium, manganese, or combinations of these elements is designated as 7XX series. Here zinc is certainly is the major alloying element, but it also may contain small additions of copper, magnesium, chromium, or manganese, or combinations of this. Next one, an alloy, what say aluminum alloy with tin as the major alloying element is designated as 8XX series. Here tin is the major alloying element. Again, there is another unused series, 9XX series. It is not used. So this is the what say basis for the classification of the aluminum alloys. So aluminum alloys are classified based on the major alloying element, and they are designated different series. Now this is the classification, right? So what say a conclusion, as per the American National Standards Institute, ANSI. Again, we will see how they are classified. 1XX series means it is almost the pure aluminum, except that there will be what say little amounts of residual elements and minor alloying elements. 1XX are the pure alloy, pure aluminum. Next one, 2XX series are the what say copper based aluminum alloys. Copper is the main major alloying element. In the 3XX series, silicon is the what's a major alloying element. Along with silicon, magnesium or copper or magnesium or copper will be present. In the 4XX series, only silicon is the main alloying element, major alloying element. In the 5XX series, magnesium is the main major alloying element. In the 7XX series, zinc is the major alloying element. In the 8XX series, tin is the main alloying element. So we can see, so these are the codes. We can later we will see different types of what say designations. Like 3, 5, 6, the most popularly used what say aluminum alloy. So each what say these numerals will be interpreting some information. Now let us learn about 1XX series alloys. In the 1XX series, aluminum is 99% minimum. Minimum there must be 99% aluminum. Sometimes it will be even more than 99%. Now the second two digits, one means certainly it is the what say 99% aluminum is there, no doubt in that. The second two digits indicate the minimum aluminum percentage when expressed to the nearest what say 0.01%. For example, you see there may be a series like say 100.1. So this is the designation of an alloy. What does it mean? It means the aluminum is what say 99% aluminum. Again, sometimes there may be a what say grade 170.1. What does it mean? Already one is there, means 99, definitely it will be there. What is this 70? Means 99.70% aluminum. The last two digits indicate the product form. Again, we can see decimals are there, like 0.1 here we can see, right? Sometimes 0 will be there. What is the meaning, right? For example, 1XX.0 is for castings and 1XX.1 is for the ingots. 0 means it is for the castings and 1 means it is for the ingots. Next let us see the 2XX series to 8XX series. First digit indicates the main alloying element. Starting from 2 to 8, first what say digit indicates the main alloying element. From 2XXS through 8XX alloy designations, the second and third digits have no numerical significance, but serve only to identify the various alloys in the group. The second what say digits, they may not indicate the exact proportion of the alloys, but they will tell us about the other alloying elements, the presence of the other alloying elements. Again, not only what say we can see 2XXS will be there, 3XX will be there, 4XXS say till 8XX series are there. Of course, 0 will be there, decimal, and 0.1 will be there. 0 means casting, 1 means ingot. Now these are the suffixes. Now there will be prefixes will be there, like A356. Likewise, there will be A will be there, B will be there. What is the meaning? Letter A indicates the first modification of the original alloy. Similarly, letter B indicates the second modification of the same alloy, and so on. Modifications indicate changes in the original alloy's chemical compositions. So these are the information about the 2XX to 8XX series. Now first let us see, let us learn about 2XX series something more. In this 2XX series aluminum copper alloys, the majority of aluminum copper alloys grades contain 4 to 5% copper. Certainly, someone says that the alloy's designation is 2XX something, means it's the major alloying element is copper because 2 is present. Now what is the proportion? The proportion of copper will be 4 to 5%. For example, so these are the important alloys, important 2XX series. Say 201.0, 208.0, 222.0, likewise. So these are the important series. Now what are the applications of the 2XX series? Cylinder heads for automotives and aircraft engines, pistons for diesel engines, exhaust system parts and many more. So these are used in the automotives. So this is the chemical composition of some 2XX cast alloys, and here we can see this is the designation 201.0, 208.0, 222.0. Now these are the alloying elements: silicon, copper, manganese, here it is zinc and titanium. And here we can see this is the 201 and silicon is 0.1 maximum, and this is the major alloying element 4 to 5.2. And in the case of the 208.0, silicon will be 2.5 to 3.5, and remember in this series the copper is the major alloying element and its proportion will be 3.5 to 4.5. again 222.0, maximum silicon will be 2% and the copper will be 9.2 to 10.7%, and there will be other elements like zinc and titanium. So these are this is the microstructure modifying element, and balance is the iron. In the triple XX series, means what does it mean? The major alloying element will be silicon along with magnesium and copper. You can see here aluminium, silicon, magnesium and copper. Silicon is definitely present. Along with silicon, either magnesium or copper, sometimes both. The majority of these alloys grades contain 6 to 10% silicon, 0.2 to 0.5% magnesium, and 0.25 to 4% copper. Important alloys in this 3XX series are, say, 319.0, 320.0, 333.0, 356.0. So this 356 is very popular. And what are the applications? Automotive cylinder blocks, car wheels, aircraft fittings, casings and other parts of compressors and pumps. So these are the typical applications of 3XX series. And here we can see, so this is the chemical composition of some 3XX alloys. Designation is, say, 333.0, and this is the silicon will be present from 8 to 10%, copper will be present 3 to 4%, manganese 0.5 maximum, magnesium 0.05 to 0.5%, zinc 1% is the maximum, titanium 0.25%. And 356.0, silicon will be 6.5 to 7.5, copper 0.25 maximum, manganese 0.35 is the maximum, and again it contains magnesium 0.22 to 0.45, zinc 0.35 maximum, and titanium 0.25 maximum. Remember, in this series, 3XX series, silicon is the major alloying element. Not only silicon, along with silicon, copper and magnesium are also present, either copper or magnesium or both, and the balance is aluminium. Next one, 4XX series. 4 means the majority of these alloys contain 4 to 13% silicon. Here the once 4 is present, the major alloying element is silicon, and the silicon's proportion will be 4 to 13%. And what are the important alloys in this series? 413.0, 443.0, and so on. And what are the applications? Pump casings, cookware, thin wall castings, likewise. And remember, here thin wall castings can be produced successfully. Why? Because silicon is up to 13%. Silicon offers the more maximum fluidity to the casting alloy. Why? Because during solidification it releases latent heat of fusion. Because of that, the fluidity will be enhancing. That is how the thin walled castings can be successfully made using this series, 4XX series. Now this is the chemical compositions of some 4XX cast alloys. Now here we can see this is the designation 413.0, 443.0, and the silicon composition is 11 to 13%, copper 1% maximum, manganese 0.35% maximum, magnesium 0.1% maximum, zinc 0.5%. And in the 443 series, silicon will be 4.5 to 6%, copper 6% maximum, manganese 0.5% maximum, magnesium 0.05% maximum, zinc 0.05% maximum, and titanium 0.25% maximum. And remember, in this series, 4XX series, the silicon is the major alloying element and the balance is aluminium. Next one, 5XX series. These are the aluminium magnesium alloys, means magnesium is the major alloying element. Majority of these alloys grades contain 4 to 10% magnesium. What are the important alloys? 514.0, 518.0, and these are the what say typical applications: chemical and sieves, kitchen utensils, and mostly sand castings. Chemical compositions of some 5XX cast alloys. So this is the designation: 514.0 and 518.0. Silicon will be 0.35 maximum, copper 0.15 maximum, manganese 0.35 maximum, magnesium 3.5 to 4.5, zinc 0.15 to maximum, titanium 0.25% maximum. In the 518.0, silicon will be 0.35% maximum, copper will be 0.25 maximum, manganese 0.35% maximum, and magnesium 7.5 to 8.5. zinc will be present say maximum 0.15, and the balance is aluminium. Remember, in this 5XX series, magnesium is the major alloying element. Now let us see the 7XX series. What is the 7XX series? The majority of these alloy grades contain 2 to 8% zinc. Zinc is the major alloying element. Now these are the important alloys, like alloys 705.0, 713.0. Now these are the applications. These are not suitable for high temperature applications due to rapid softening, because zinc is present, it melts at a very low temperature. So it is, they are not suitable for high temperature applications, right? Sacrificial anode for steel structure production. So these are used as the sacrificial anode for steel structure production against corrosion. Next one, marine castings, right? Form machinery. So this zinc offers resistance against corrosion. Now these are the chemical compositions of some 7XX cast alloys. Designation, you see, so this is 705.0, 713.0. In the 705.0, silicon will be 0.2 maximum percent, copper will, there will be copper 0.2 maximum, manganese 0.4 to 0.6%, magnesium 1.4 to 1.8%, zinc 2.7 to 3.3, titanium 0.25% maximum, and there will be other elements like chromium 0.2 to 0.4%. And in the 713.0, 0.25% maximum silicon will be there, and copper will be from 0.4 to 1%, manganese 0.6 maximum percent, magnesium 0.2 to 0.5%, zinc 7 to 8%, and titanium maximum 0.25% will be there, and the balance is aluminium. And remember, zinc is the major alloying element in the 7XX series. Next, let us see the 8XX series. So in this series, tin is the major alloying element. Majority of these alloying grades contain 5 to 7% tin. Important alloys, alloys say 752.0. So this is the most important alloy. Now what are the applications? Monometal, bimetal side bearings for internal combustion engines and other applications. These are the chemical compositions: 852.0, silicon 0.4 maximum, copper 1.7 to 2.3, manganese 0.1% maximum, magnesium 0.6 to 0.9, there won't be zinc, and titanium 0.25% maximum, and other elements like tin so this is the major alloying element here, 5.5 to 7%, and other alloying elements like nickel 0.9 to 1.5%, and the balance is aluminium. Here in this series, tin is the major alloying element. Now so far we have completed the aluminium cast alloys. Now let us see the magnesium cast alloys. Now the first question is, why magnesium? It is the lightest structural metal. Its density is 1.8 grams per cubic centimeter, whereas for aluminium the density is 2.7 grams per cubic centimeter. Here it is 1.7, means almost 1 gram less compared to the aluminium. Can be cast thinner and faster, can be machined easier than aluminium, better dimensional stability, high specific strength and high damping capacity, good thermal conductivity, and 100% recyclability. So these are all the benefits compared to the aluminium alloys. That is why slowly magnesium alloys are replacing aluminium alloys. But pure magnesium is volatile at high temperatures. It is extremely corrosive in wet environments. Alloying with elements like aluminium, zinc, copper, etc. will improve the properties. So, at any cost we cannot use the pure magnesium, right. We have to alloy it with different elements like aluminium, zinc, copper and so on. Now, these are the advantages of magnesium alloys. Castings can be made with thinner walls compared to aluminium, 1 to 1.5 mm up to 1.5 mm can be made. Castings cool more quickly due to a reduced latent heat of fusion per unit volume. The what is a solidification time is much lesser compared to aluminium. High what is a gate pressures can be achieved using moderate pressures due to the low density of magnesium. Mainly it is used in the what is a die castings. So, that time say during the pressure die casting we need to what is a apply higher pressure, but when we use the magnesium even what is a moderate pressure will be enough, because why? There is the density of the magnesium is low. Iron from castings casting dies has low solubility in magnesium alloys, which reduces any tendency to die soldering. Now, this is mainly used in the die castings, right. So, what is the problem with the die castings? So, in the die castings the dies are the ferrous alloys. Now, what happens is the iron from the dies may react with the magnesium. That would not happen here. In the case of the aluminum alloys it may happen, but here it has got the low solubility. That is how this soldering defect can be minimized. Again, now we will see the classification of the magnesium cast alloys. As per ASTM system, the classification comprises two capital letters followed by two or three numbers. There will be two letters will be there. Again, followed these two letters will be followed by two or three digits. The two capital letters stand for the two major alloying elements. The first letter indicates the highest alloying element and the second letter indicates the second highest alloying element. The two numbers after the two letters, there will be two numbers will be there. These two numbers stand for the amount of the two major alloying elements. The first number stands for the percentage weight of the first letter element. Second number stands for the percentage weight of the second alloying element. Now, different letters and their significances. In the what is a classification, we will see for example, AZ-91, what does it mean? Say aluminum will be the major alloying element, zinc will be the next major alloying element, and 9 indicates the proportion of aluminum and 1 indicates the proportion of zinc. Likewise, several letters are used. We can see here A means aluminum, B means bismuth, C means copper, D means cadmium, E means rare earth metals, F means iron, G means magnesium, H means thorium, K means zirconium, L means lithium, M means manganese, N means nickel, P means lead, Q means silver, R means chromium, S means silicon, T means tin, W means yttrium and Z means zinc. Examples, AZ-91, this is the most popular alloy. The magnesium alloy contains, you see, aluminium. Here this is a magnesium alloy and aluminium is the main alloying element. Next one, zinc is the second alloying element. The magnesium alloy contains 9% aluminium and 1% zinc. That is the meaning of AZ-91. Similarly, QE-22, what does it mean? The magnesium, it is a magnesium alloy, it contains 2% silver and 2% rare earth metals. Means here QE is present, that represents silver, presence of silver. E is there, that represents the presence of rare earth metals, 2% silver and 2% rare earth metals. Next one, AC-63, you see, this is again a magnesium alloy, it contains 6%, here A means aluminium and it contains 3% copper. Now, this is the direction of magnesium alloys development, and this is the magnesium, and here we can see as we what say add aluminium, magnesium, manganese, it will be AM50, AM60, and here we will be adding aluminium, calcium, and we can see here and rare earth metals, zinc, manganese. And here we will be adding aluminium, calcium, rare earth, magnesium, zinc and rare earth likewise. So this way when we mix the alloying elements, we get ductile alloys. And here we can see, here we are adding aluminium and zinc and it becomes AZ91. And here we are adding aluminium and silicon, it becomes AS21, AS41. Here we are adding aluminium and rare earth metals, it becomes AE42. And here we are adding aluminium, calcium and so on. And here we are adding silver, rare earth metals, zirconium, it becomes EQ21. And here we are adding yttrium, rare earth metals, zirconium and it becomes WE54, WE43. This side when we keep on alloying the elements, here thus we will be getting creep resistance alloys. The alloys will have the very good creep resistance. And we can see here, so here we can see this ellipse indicates the high pressure die casting. Means these alloys are used for the high pressure die casting. These alloys are also used for the high pressure die casting. But this one we can see, this diamond is for the wrought alloys. So these are not the cast alloys. Again we can see this rectangle indicates the they are meant for the sand castings. These are the alloys. Here we can see this is one set and this is another set. So these two groups, they are useful for the sand castings. And here we can see fiber and hybrid reinforced magnesium materials, and if we keep add like this, we will be getting creep resistance alloys, thermal expansion alloys and Young's modulus will be improved. Likewise we can improve the develop the alloys in three directions. Now magnesium alloys for automotive applications, so these are the die casting alloys. AZ91D, it is the most widely used alloy. Next one, AM60, AM50, AM20, these are the higher ductility alloys. Next one, AE42, AS41, AS21, so these are the higher temperature alloys. Next one, ZE41, AC63, these are the heavy duty and high temperature alloys. AZ91D alloy properties: good room temperature strength, excellent die castability and good corrosion resistance. What are the applications? Steering column brackets, four wheel drive transfer case, manual transmission case, clutch pedal, brake pedal, steering column brackets, crank case, chain housing, steering box, rear link arms and subframes and so on. So these are the applications of AZ91D alloy. Next one, let us see the applications of AM60, AM50 and AM20 alloys. These are, what are the properties? They have high ductility, good impact strength, good die castability and good corrosion resistance. And what are the applications? Seat frames, wheels, instrument panels and so on. Next one, AE42, AS41 and AS21 alloys. What are the properties? Good strength and creep resistance at temperatures above 120 degrees centigrade, but poor castability. Applications: automatic transmission case. Next one, ZE41, AC63 alloys. What are the properties? Sand castings, good room temperature strength and improved castability. And applications, so these are used for making the engine blocks. Friends, in this lecture we have seen different aluminium alloys and different aluminium cast alloys and different magnesium cast alloys. And we have seen how the aluminium cast alloys have been classified. They are classified based on the major alloying elements, the 1XX series, 2XX series and so on. And we have also seen how the magnesium cast alloys have been classified, like AZ91 and so on. Again, so this AZ91, remember, so there will be two letters will be there. These two letters indicate the two main alloying elements, and there will be two digits will be there. These two digits will be reflecting the or indicating the proportion of the two alloying elements. Likewise, so there will be different classifications of the magnesium alloys will be there, we have seen. And nowadays slowly the magnesium alloys are replacing the aluminium alloys. Why? Because the density of magnesium alloys what is lesser than the density of the magnesium alloys, and their castability is very high, even very thin sections can be made. So that is how magnesium alloys are gaining more and more importance these days. But the problem is with the magnesium alloys while melting, right? So the melting has to be done very carefully. The magnesium can explode if it is melted in a open atmosphere. That's why always the magnesium is melted in a closed environment, closed and controlled environment. That is how the melting of magnesium becomes expensive. No problem, it may become little expensive compared to the melting of aluminum, but the properties of magnesium alloys are much better compared to the properties of aluminum alloys. So in the next class we will be seeing other non ferrous cast metals. Until then, thank you and goodbye.